This is Joseph Drust, and welcome to ZBrushCore. In this tutorial, as it may be your first introduction to the world of 3D sculpting, we're going to talk about the fundamentals of ZBrushCore. We're going to talk about navigation, the brushes, and other elements as we work to create a 3D printable keychain. So to start off, you're going to launch ZBrushCore, and you're going to notice this window at the top here. This window at the top is called Lightbox. Lightbox is ZBrushCore's file management system. In here, you'll see a series of projects that you can load to start sculpting on. Or through this Open File button up here, you can import in files from other applications or load a previous saved file. For this tutorial, we're going to select this keychain heart right here. To select an object, just simply click on it, and then to load it in, just simply double-click. After you double-click, you should see the model loaded into ZBrushCore here. Now, before we start sculpting on this mesh, let's talk about navigation. To rotate around your model, simply click on a blank spot of your canvas and drag, and this will perform a rotate. As you're rotating your mesh, if you hold down Shift, this will allow you to snap into certain angles. So if you're hovering close to the front of your model and you hold down Shift, it's going to snap into a front angle. If you're hovering close to the side of your model and you hold down Shift, it's going to snap into a side angle. So using this rotation option along with holding Shift, you'll be able to snap into different angles of your model as you work. Now, after you have rotation down, we can talk about moving or panning. To perform a move or a pan, simply hold down the Alt key, click on a blank spot on your canvas, and drag, and this will perform a move or a pan. So that process again is hold down Alt, click and drag on a blank spot on the canvas, and that'll allow you to move your model like so. So now we can rotate, and we can also move our model. Now, in addition to rotating and moving, we can also perform a zoom or scale. One method of doing this is first holding down the Alt button, like you're going to perform a pan, click on your canvas and hold it, then release Alt and drag, and that will allow you to zoom your model. So that process again is hold Alt, click on your canvas like you're going to perform a move or a pan, release Alt and drag, and that will allow you to zoom. Now, if you don't feel comfortable using these hotkeys to navigate around your model, there's also these buttons over here. So this Move button, if you click and drag it, will perform that move.
The Zoom 3D button,
if you click and drag it, will perform that scale or that zoom. And the Rotate button here, if you click and drag, will allow you to perform that rotate. So using these buttons here, or the hotkeys, you can now start navigating around your model as you sculpt. Now, after you have navigation down, we can start talking about ZBrushCore's brush system. So down here at the bottom, you have a series of brushes. To load a brush, just come over and simply click, and that brush will now be loaded. With a brush loaded, such as clay buildup, if you come across your model and simply click and drag, this will perform a sculpt function. And this is going to allow you to sculpt positively on the surface of your model. If you hold down Alt and then click and drag, this will allow you to perform a negative sculpt or carve into your model. So to sculpt positively, just click and drag. To sculpt negatively, hold down Alt and click and drag. And that will allow you to start changing the surface of your mesh as you work. Now, in addition to just sculpting positively and sculpting negatively, you can also smooth out the surface. To do this, hold down Shift and click and drag, and this will perform a smooth function. So now you can click and drag to sculpt positively, hold Alt and drag to sculpt negatively, and then hold Shift to smooth out those areas. If you want to change the size of your brush at any time, you can navigate up to the top here to this Draw Size slider, and simply click and drag, and that will change your brush size. Or if you're over top of your model, just simply click the S button, and this will also open up this draw slider, and you can now change the draw size here. So this will allow you to change your stroke size in order to sculpt various levels of detail. Now, another thing to notice is that ZBrushCore works with the pressure sensitivity of your device. So if you simply do a very light sculpt on your mesh, you're going to get a very light stroke. If you really press down hard and drag, you're going to get a very harsh stroke. So using this pressure sensitivity, you can come through and start sculpting on your model in various degrees. And then your Shift brush also respects this pressure sensitivity as well. So if you hold down Shift and press lightly, it's going to do a light smooth. And if you hold down Shift and press hard, it's going to do a strong smooth. Now, if you make a stroke on your model and you're not particularly happy with it, you can also undo that stroke. So if you press Ctrl plus Z, this will perform an undo action. If you keep pressing Ctrl plus C, you can undo all the way back to your original model. So as you can see here, I can return back to this area of my mesh. Now, if at any point you went back too far, you can hold Ctrl Shift plus Z, and this will perform a redo. So Ctrl Z will undo, and Ctrl Shift plus Z will redo. Another thing to note is as I'm sculpting on this model, I'm doing it in a symmetrical fashion. So if I sculpt on one side of the mesh, you can see the stroke is repeated on the other side. If you want to disable symmetry, simply press X on your keyboard and this will turn symmetry off. So now if I come across my model on this side and sculpt, you'll see that effect is not happening on the other side. So to turn symmetry back on, just simply hit X and that'll turn it back on. So pressing X will allow you to toggle symmetry on or off as you work. So now, in addition to brushes like clay buildup, there's also some other brushes down here that are pretty interesting. So let's come down here and select the move brush. So to select the brush again, just simply click it, and that brush will now become your active brush. Then I'm just going to hover over an area of my model. I'm going to tap S to bring up that draw size slider, and I'm just going to increase the draw size like so. Now I'm just going to rotate my model around, and I'm going to click and drag using this move brush. Now, as I click and drag with this brush, you're going to notice it's going to allow me to move that surface geometry. So I can start pulling areas of the model out. So this will allow you to make really large profile changes on your mesh. Now, as you're pulling this out, you may also notice that the surface of the model here is becoming a little bit angular. So if I look down here, it's pretty smooth, but then up here, it's getting a little bit rough. So this is happening because we're stretching out the surface of the model as we work. So let's say now I switch back to that clay buildup brush and I hit S on my keyboard to get a smaller draw size there. And I want to make a mark from here on the model all the way up to here. So if I click and drag and start drawing this mark out, you're going to see as I reach this area up here, my stroke is depreciating. So this area up here does not look the same as this area down here. And this is because we pulled or distorted our mesh to this point. Well, ZBrushCore has a function called Dynamesh. And Dynamesh is ZBrushCore's digital clay. And what this function will allow us to do is allow us to redistribute the surface of my model. So if we make a stroke here and continue it all the way up to here, the stroke will be consistent. So Dynamesh lives under the tool palette. So if we navigate to the tool palette over here and then open up the Geometry tab and then open up the Dynamesh tab, you'll see this big Dynamesh button. Right now, this model has Dynamesh active. So what this means, if I hold down Control, and drag off my model like so, and then release, the model will be re-dynameshed. So you can see the model surface has changed. So now if I come back and sculpt from here all the way up to the top here, you're gonna see I'm gonna get a consistent stroke all the way across. So let's undo this and just show this thing one more time. So let's take our model and we're gonna go grab that move brush again. We're gonna hover over the surface of the model again, hold down S to get a large draw size. I'm just gonna pull out this model like so. Just get it really, really rough. And you can also do this with any of the sculpting brushes as well. So if I switch back to that clay buildup, go to a small draw size, and then start carving into the model here like so. At any point, if you start seeing this roughness happen to your model, you simply hold Control, drag off your model, and release, and it's going to redistribute that surface. Then you come back through with holding Shift to smooth that area out, and then just continue sculpting like normal. So using this Dynamesh option, along with these sculpting brushes, you can start pulling out really large shapes on your model. So if I go back to that move brush, change that draw size, and just start pulling these out, and then just hold Control, drag off to re-Dynamesh, you can just continue pulling on the surface of your model to get really interesting designs and details. Now, another thing that's really nice about Dynamesh is that if I come through and say set a small draw size and start pulling this surface and then bump it into the other surface in the middle, if I re-Dynamesh, it's going to now weld those two parts together. So now these two parts are joined. So now I come through and smooth this out and I can actually start bridging areas of my model like this. So if I want to make another bridge between this surface of the model and the surface of the model here, I can simply just click and drag, make sure they connect, then perform that re-Dynamesh option, and now they have been connected together. So you can use this functionality to come through and start making really intricate designs on your meshes. So now that we've talked about Dynamesh, there's one more thing I want to talk about, and that is masking. So I'm going to come up to Lightbox up here and just open this up to go back into our ZBrushCore file management system here. And I'm just going to locate that keychain heart again and double click it. And this is just going to reload this project. Now it's going to ask if I want to save changes from my current mesh. This time I'm just going to hit no. And now I'm going to be brought back to a new version of that keychain. So inside of ZBrushCore, as you're using a brush, say like the clay buildup brush, at any time, if you want to protect an area on your mesh, you can simply hold down Control, and this will put you in a masking brush. So while holding Control and having this masking brush selected, if you come across your model and drag, this will perform a mask on the surface of your mesh. Now this masked area on your model is now going to be protected from any sculpting you do. So with this clay buildup brush still selected, if I come across my model and just start dragging a stroke out and then go through that mask, you're going to see that that masked area has now been protected. So this will allow you to come through and mask out certain areas on your mesh and then create interesting designs or shapes around them. So let's undo that back to our mask here. Now, if you mask an area on your model and you want to clear the mask, you can simply hold Control and click off the model like we did a re-Dynamesh, and that will clear the mask. If we apply that mask again by holding Control and clicking and dragging, let's say we want to invert the mask now. To invert the mask, just hold Control and then just tap off the model, and that will allow you to invert the mask. So those processes again are Control plus drag to mask your model, Control plus drag off your model to clear the mask, and then Control plus click to invert your mask. So using these options, you can come through and start masking out different areas on your meshes to get different shapes or designs. So now that we've covered most of the fundamentals of ZBrushCore, we can now start sculpting our keychain. So before I do this, I'm just going to reset my scene again. So I'm just going to navigate up here to Lightbox. I'm going to locate that keychain heart and just load that back in again. And now I have a fresh scene here with the keychain, and I'm ready to start sculpting. So I want to make a quick little elephant keychain here. So have a little sculpted elephant in the middle and have his ears on the sides, and then have his trunk come down and do a bend to one side. So I'm just going to make sure I have that clay buildup brush selected, and I'm just going to start describing some of these forms. So I'm going to start flushing out his ear here and maybe give these ears a little bit of a curly Q type feeling to them. Now, if you're working on very thin pieces of geometry and you start using a large brush size, so let's increase my draw size here, you may notice that if you sculpt on one side of the model, it will start affecting the other side as well. So we can disable this so this doesn't happen by turning on backface masking. So if we come up to the brush palette here and then open up the auto masking tab, there's a button here called backface mask. So if we activate this and now we sculpt on our model with a large brush again, you're going to notice that it's only going to affect the front side of the model. So if you have thin pieces of geometry like this keychain here and you're using a very large brush size, you may want to just navigate to this brush palette over here, open up the auto masking area, and turn on backface masking. So it's going to help you sculpt some of these details out like so. But at this point, I'm just going to go back to that small draw size here and I'm just going to start sculpting these details out. So just using the positive functionality, so just clicking and dragging on the mesh to sculpt in a positive fashion, and then holding Alt to sculpt in a negative fashion, and then using Shift to smooth different areas out. So this is all the processes I'm going to use to create this keychain here. So just using that clay buildup brush to build these forms. If my topology gets a little bit too stretched, I can always just hold Control and click off the model, and that will apply that Dynamesh again and give me an even surface. Then I come back in and smooth and sculpt more details as needed. The only other part that's a little bit complex on this is the creating of the elephant's trunk here. So I want it to go down and go to one side. So I'm just going to turn symmetry off as I draw this one out and just start drawing it out like so to give it a little more interest or a little more design here. And then I'm just going to go back to the body here and go in like a crosshatch fashion here to build up a connection from the trunk to the rest of his head. And then I'm gonna turn symmetry back on, and to generate his tusks, just come across the area here and start drawing in a circular fashion like so, and re-dynamesh that. Then you can select the move brush and go to the side here and just move these parts here to get those tusks fleshed out, smooth those down using that move option there. And then we go back to the clay buildup brush, re-dynamesh, and just continue sculpting. So I'm just going to jump ahead here to the final version of the elephant that I quickly sculpted. So here we have the completed elephant key ring here inside of ZBrushCore.
So you can see I just quickly used the processes we just talked about to sculpt out the different areas on the model here. Used a lot of the smoothing processes and the alternate functionality to carve in and out all these surfaces. And just came through and described the different forms here to get the shape of an elephant. Now, after you have a model completed and you're happy with it, you can now export this out for 3D printing. ZBrushCore can export out to multiple file formats. You can export out to an OBJ, an STL, or a VRML file. Now, ZBrushCore has the ability to allow you to sculpt on millions of polygons. This is great for describing different details and forms on your meshes, but not always great for 3D printing. So inside of ZBrushCore, there is an option to allow you to optimize your models so they can be 3D printed. If we navigate over here to the file menu and open that up, in here there is a 3D printing area. If we open this up, there are three buttons here. The top button is called Optimize for 3D Printing. This is going to take your model and look at the sculptural details and optimize the areas where there are no sculptural details, reducing the poly count of your mesh. So this mesh currently is at 600,000 points. If you know that your 3D printing software cannot handle this many polygons, you can come to the file menu here and simply click Optimize for 3D Printing. This is going to look at those details and it's going to reduce your mesh. Now, depending on how many polygons you have, this process could take a little while. After this is complete, you will have your model here in its reduced state. So you can see the active points now are down to 100,000 polygons. Now, if I undo the process here, you're not going to see any change. So here's the model at 600,000 polys, and then if I redo the optimized process, here is the model at 100,000 polys. So this process here is extremely powerful at reducing your model, but holding all your structural details. So if you're doing any sort of 3D printing, it's highly recommended that you optimize your mesh before printing it. Now, directly below this button, you have the buttons that will allow you to optimize and export to STL and optimize and export to VRML. So the STL file format does not support color. So if you have painted your model inside of ZBrushCore and you want to create a color 3D print, you need to use this Optimize and VRML export button here. Now, if you need to just export your model out as an OBJ, you can do that through the tool palette. So if you navigate over here to Tool, there's this export button here, and this will allow you to export your mesh out as an OBJ. So that is the process of quickly coming through and creating a keychain model inside of ZBrushCore for 3D printing. Thanks for watching, and I look forward to see what you create with ZBrushCore.